The Lord be with you. Good morning and welcome to worship with First Presbyterian Church on this wet Lord's Day, the first Sunday of Advent. Advent means arrival or coming. The season of Advent is a season of preparation for Christmas and the coming of the Lord Jesus. We're glad you're here to begin our Advent Christmas celebration, and that you have ventured the, what's a good word for this weather? Wet, yeah, soggy weather to be here with us. The weather is conspiring against us this morning, but it has come to our attention that with our worship attendance increasing in recent months, that the handicapped parking spaces are filling up. So we'd like those of you who are able-bodied to park further from the building. If you could do that, you will assist those who are less mobile to find a closer parking space, and you will also get more steps in by walking farther from your car. So if you could park a little further from the building if you are able-bodied, and that will allow our mobility-impaired folks to find a closer spot. I want to highlight a few opportunities to prepare for Christmas during this Advent season in addition to our Advent worship services. One is the angel tree. The angel tree is up, it is decorated, and you are invited to grab an ornament off the tree, which is a gift request, and also write down your name on the pad next to the tree so we know what gift you have committed to purchasing. And if you haven't done that already, head to that tree right after worship because they do tend to be all gone by the end of this service, this day. And then on December 16th, Saturday, December 16th, we have a Gifts of the Magi event downstairs in Doran Hall, Saturday, December 16th from 9 to 11. And this is a free shopping event for children. So we invite you to bring your children or grandchildren to shop for free for gifts, and I have just learned that you have been so gracious, so generous in your donations that we don't want any more. Please, no more donations. We have been inundated by your kindness with donations, so we don't need any more of those. What we need now is children. We need children to come to that event. Again, it's Saturday, December 16th, 9 to 11 in Doran Hall, so invite children. Bring children, bring your grandchildren, bring your great-grandchildren, and it should be a blast on the 16th. I think that's it for now. The Apostle Paul proclaims, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice."
I've never seen those angels over there on that wall before. And I've been here over 20 years. And I don't know where they came from, but I'm really glad they're here. Thank you.
Please stand in body or in spirit for the call to worship. Jesus says, I am coming soon.
Amen.
Let's sing God's praise. Are like a filthy cloth. The Apostle Paul proclaims that we have been clothed in Christ, confident that Christ's robe of righteousness covers our rags of sin, confident that Christ has got us covered. Let us confess our sin, first in unison and then in silence. Let us pray together. Holy and loving God, when your light shines, nothing is hidden. And when your light shines on us, there is joy in seeing and discomfort in being seen. Help us by your love to bear the light of your truth and your integrity, your forgiveness and your faithfulness. Bring us out of hiding that we may become children of light. And hear now, we ask, our silent prayers of confession. Create in us clean hearts, O Lord, and renew right spirits within us. Amen. Hear the good news. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ came to save sinners. Friends in Christ, we are forgiven. The peace of Christ be with you. Let's take a moment to pass the peace of Christ and other greetings to our neighbors. Thank you.
Emmanuel, Son of God, appear. Heaven and earth rejoice, salvation is drawing near. Salvation is drawing near. Come, come, Emmanuel, Son of God, appear. Heaven and earth rejoice, salvation is drawing near. Salvation is drawing near.
And I'd invite any of the young disciples to come up here and join me. Please, I see some of you. Isaac, you're gonna come? Great, thanks. Rachel, are you gonna come too? Come on. All right, we'll let her decide. Good morning. It's great to see you. Happy New Year. Happy New Year? Are you a little confused? Yes, okay. So. You might be wondering, what do I mean by Happy New Year? It's December. We still have a whole month until January, right? But in the church, we keep track of time in two different ways. I think you might know this. So we, you know, like everybody else, we keep track of time with the regular calendar, like Mondays and Tuesdays and so on, and January, February, etc. But in the church, we also keep track of time in a different way, too. And so we keep track of time in a way that reminds us of all the things that happened in Jesus' life. And so, as you know, we're approaching Christmas, and so we start the new year now, and we call this first season Advent. And do you have any idea what Advent means? Yeah, so Advent means arrival. And so, you know who we're waiting to arrive, right? Jesus, right? Yeah. So we're waiting for Jesus to arrive, and so it's a season of waiting and preparation. So we're getting ready for Jesus. And as you know, we have a lot of ways to do this. So, and it's a season. So just like we have seasons outside, we have seasons inside. And as we look around, we have changed the way things look in here, right? So we have lots of decorations as part of our way of marking the season. And what are some of the things you see? Wreaths, yeah. Candles, yeah, we see lots of candles. What color do you see?
Purple,
yeah, we see a lot of purple. So Christmas, outside of the church, we see a lot of red and green. But inside the church, we see purple, because purple is the color of preparation, and it's the color of royalty, like kings and queens and princes and princesses. So we remember that Jesus is a king. And so we're getting ready for Jesus' arrival. So as we're getting ready, we, in this season, we have some things that we think about. So we have some different themes. And as you know, we have an Advent wreath. We've talked about these before a little bit. I think you remember from previous years. And we light a different candle each day, each week, each Sunday, for each week. And each candle represents a different theme. And so this week, our theme is hope. So, how would you describe hope?
I would describe it as like a feeling of like a good feeling of like what's gonna happen next.
Yeah, yeah, a good feeling about what's gonna happen. Yeah, would you add anything to that? Okay, yeah, so it's a good feeling about what's going to happen. Yeah, and so it's something that we don't know for sure is going to happen, but we really want it to happen. And it's more than a wish. A wish might or might not come true, but with hope, we really, really want it to come true, and we're pretty sure that it will, and combined, you know, we think it must happen. And so hope gives us it gives us energy to keep doing things, working toward it, and it keeps us going, right? So when we're hopeful, we're like, I really hope that that's going to happen. Like, Jesus gives us hope. And so because Jesus gives us hope, we can keep doing all the things that we know we're supposed to do, even when it's hard sometimes. So that's one of the things that we think of during Advent, and this first Sunday is the Sunday of hope. And so we light the candle of hope. And so as we go through the season, you know that we have the Advent candle. We light it in church every week. We're going to do that in just a moment. But we can celebrate, we can remember this at home, too. And so I have this little, we have this coloring page here. I'll give you one too, but let me show you first. So it has this piece, and so you put that on the table, and you can color it in. See, I've colored mine. We have three candles that are purple and one that's pink, so it actually goes purple, purple, pink, purple. So if you want, you can color it like that. And so we'll put that, you can color it like that, and then each week we have a coloring page. Let's see if I can show you. Just like this, see? And then you can color it. I've just colored mine like that. You can color all the different colors you want. And then you cut it out, and then you roll it around like this, and you can either tape or glue it, and then bend these out. Oops, I should have done that first. Just like that. And then you can put it there. Like, you light your little candle just like that. And then you can put it somewhere where you see it during the week, like on your kitchen table or maybe in your bedroom. And then we have a little prayer which you're going to say a little bit later. And you can say it every day to remind us, to help you remember to be thinking about hope. So you can say it like your family might say it at dinner time if you eat dinner together, or you can say it maybe when you go to bed, just to kind of keep you thinking about hope during this week. And then next week, we'll talk about a different theme, and we'll do the same thing. So then throughout the Advent season, you'll end up with a whole wreath with all your little candles, like lit just like that. It's all fun. All right, so I have one for you, but I'll give that to you in a minute. So we are going to light our candle here for all of us. And would you like to help me? Great. All right, so we have this piece that we read at the beginning, and then we light the candle. Would you like to light the candle? I know you'll be responsible about that. So, okay, come on. All right, so we take this, and then let's go light it from, we'll light it from the Christ candle here. All right, and you want to hold that really carefully while I read the liturgy, and then I'll tell you when to light the candle. All right. Let us light our candle together. Today we begin the celebration of Advent, at a time when we prepare ourselves to celebrate anew God's gift of himself to us as a child in Bethlehem, that's Jesus, and when we renew our faith in the fulfillment of God's promise to come again to complete the work of the world's redemption begun in him. So hear now the words of the prophet Isaiah. Darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. So we light this candle as a symbol of the light of Christ coming into the world. Go ahead, you can light one purple candle. With Christ comes the light of hope. Let us say together, let us walk in the light of the Lord, who is our hope. That is a little tricky. Here we go. I know. There you go. And then you just pull this down just a little bit. Perfect. Okay, and then you can hang it right there. All right, let's pray. Everyone can repeat after me. Join me, please. Dear God, who gives us hope, thank you for inviting us to this time of waiting. Help us to open our eyes so we can see your light, to open our ears so we can hear your words of hope, to open our minds so we can understand you, and to open our hearts so we can receive your love. Come, long expected Jesus. We are waiting for you. Amen. All right. Isaac, we need, let's see. Go ahead.
hope, peace, joy, love. These four theological virtues, or fruit of the Spirit, are themes that are often attached to the Advent candles, one for each of the four Sundays of the season that starts today. This year, we're using an Advent wreath liturgy written by J. Dudley Weaver, Jr., a former pastor of First Presbyterian Church in Portland, that focuses on these four themes. We've just heard the liturgy for the first Sunday of Advent. It concludes, "Let us walk in the light of the Lord, who is our hope." Next Sunday, the second Sunday of Advent, the wreath liturgy will conclude, "Let us walk in the light of the Lord, who is our hope and peace." On the third Sunday of Advent, we will say, "Let us walk in the light of the Lord, who is our hope, our peace, and our joy." The third Sunday of Advent is also called Gaudete Sunday. Gaudete is a Latin word that means rejoice. Finally, on the fourth Sunday of Advent, which is also Christmas Eve this year, we will name all four Advent virtues. Let us walk in the light of the Lord, who is our hope, our peace, our joy, the gift of God's love. Hope, peace, joy, love. Each Sunday of Advent, our scripture readings will help us to explore that day's theme, that day's virtue. On this first Sunday of Advent, we're pondering hope. And helping us to do so is Isaiah 64, 1 through 9, part of an Old Testament book that early Christian writers sometimes called the fifth gospel because of how frequently the four canonical gospels quote or allude to it. When the gospel writers reflected on the story of Jesus, they heard echoes of Isaiah, and they sprinkled these echoes throughout their theological biographies. As we prepare to hear Isaiah 64, 1 through 9, and the good news about hope, let us pray. Light of the world, shine on us. Amen. Isaiah 64, 1 through 9. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and all our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. Why does the lectionary recommend this passage for this liturgical day, this festival day, this holy day? That's one of the first questions I ask when I'm preparing a sermon on a lectionary text during a season like Advent or Lent. In the case of today's text, the reason the lectionary suggests it for Advent is found in the very first line. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down. Advent means coming, as in the coming of the Lord. Isaiah hopes that the Lord will come. Advent echoes this hope in its expectation that the Lord Jesus is coming. Isaiah's hope is written as a prayer, a petition. Oh, that you, God, would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. The prayer's opening lines are bookended by mentions of God's advent, of God's coming to the world. The prayer pleads with God to come as God came in the past, when the mountains quaked at God's presence, perhaps in allusion to Moses going up the mountain in the book of Exodus, which we heard several weeks ago. Paradoxically, the coming of the Lord that is hoped for is also something to be feared. The presence of God makes nations and mountains tremble. The prayer continues. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who works for those who wait for him. Words of adoration, of praise, are offered to God, concluding with an affirmation of patience. God works for those who wait for him, for those who wait patiently. Waiting is an Advent discipline. It's an Advent practice. Advent is a season of anticipation, expectation, preparation. We busy ourselves with all sorts of activities during this season, with all sorts of preparations. But in all of the hustle and bustle of the Advent Christmas season, we do one thing all the time. We wait. We wait for the coming of the Lord. As we wait, our hearts prepare Christ's room by cleaning up. Repentance is another Advent emphasis. The liturgical color for the season of Advent is purple. Purple signifies royalty. Jesus is the Prince of Peace and the King of Kings. Purple also signifies repentance. And repentance is what Isaiah's prayer turns to next. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds, even our best deeds, are like filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity." Isaiah offers confession, an essential part of repentance, of turning from sin and toward God. The Hebrew word for repentance is shuv, which means to turn around. The Greek word for repentance is metanoia, which means to change one's mind. Repentance is a changing of direction. We confess that we've been going the wrong way, and we turn around. Sin is universal. The need for forgiveness is universal. And note that Isaiah's confession is for all. Did you hear that part? We sinned. We all fade like a leaf. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you. Isaiah's confession is not only for himself, it's for everyone. It's for all. Similarly, the corporate prayers of confession that we offer in our worship services every Sunday are on behalf of the whole of humankind. Sometimes we confess sins that some of us as individuals have not committed. We know, however, that humankind as a whole has fallen short in these ways. There is no one who calls on God's name. But, thankfully, there's a but, or to be exact, a yet. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. Confession gives way to doxology, to words of glory given to God, with a beautiful image of God as a potter and people as clay. It's a hopeful image, one that shows God's power to transform sinners, molding us into a new creation. Just as God creates people, so can God recreate people. The prayer closes with the hope that God will choose creativity over destruction, that God's love for the work of God's hand will outlast God's anger. If Isaiah could hope this centuries before Jesus, how much more can we hope it on this side of the birth, life, death, and resurrection? On Christmas, we will celebrate the birth of Jesus, the coming of Christ the Lord into the world. Until then, we hope that Christ will come into our hearts anew. We hope for spiritual renewal. And may this season of Advent also move us to embrace the bold hope that Christ will come again at an unknown time and in an unknown way, transforming a world that seems hell-bent on its own destruction. Christ has come. Christ is coming. Christ will come. Amen.
I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join me in our affirmation of faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
This morning, we are asking that you place your 2024 pledge card in the offering box as you depart, if you have not already done so previously. And we have one more moment of stewardship this morning. Wilma Doan is going to share on our congregation's ministry of care to her and her family. And Wilma responded about a month ago to a request, an appeal that I made, and Wilma, I'm glad you are up for this.
Thank you. Good morning. One of the best committees I ever worked on in this church was when three of us volunteered to plan activities to celebrate our church's 125th anniversary in 2007. Susie Steffens, Mary Mulcrone, and I met at Susie's house, and it seems like we just had inspiration for ideas, and a very, very short time, we planned out a whole year with a special theme for every single month and also a special activity. And many of those activities are still happening right now within our church. For many years, we enjoyed a long weekend, a women's retreat. And one of the activities from our 125th anniversary was a used book sale. It usually was in September, back to school, books, used book sale. And the first year we used the funds from that for the activities within the celebration. And the next, after that, I had asked and received permission to set that money aside for the women's retreat. This allowed us to have the funds available easily for making that deposit on whatever venue our retreat was going to be at. And it also gave us money to buy materials for crafts. And we were also able to give scholarships for some of the people that were unable to pay the full registration fee. And this was a time I think any woman that attended felt that it was just a marvelous feeling to be in a group of Christian caring women and to be there in your jammies and just be talking and telling your whole life story. It was a special time, a very special time. We had crafts, we had music, we had lots of laughter. And even a few times, there were a few tears. We had music. It was just an incredible experience for most of us. And one of the best things, the meals we didn't have to cook for ourselves. I don't think I should even have to say this, but the last 3.5 years have been very difficult for all of us. On March 19th, 2020, my whole life came to a crashing stop when my dear, beloved husband suddenly died. And then just a few weeks later, the whole world came to a stopping crash with the COVID-19 pandemic. The death of a loved one, of course, creates lots of decisions to be made, papers to shuffle, and it wasn't even until July 11th that we were able to bury Ken because of the restrictions that were in place. And they'd been released enough to allow 10 people plus a pastor for an outside graveside service. We weren't able to have a memorial service, and that was a great disappointment. But amazingly, there were some very clever people and very caring people in our church to figure out how to have worship like we're doing this morning, broadcast over the YouTube system. And I think it would be appropriate to thank those people up in the balcony for doing all that. And then a couple of other people put together some social events for us, the Thursday afternoon and the one after church. In May 2020, I ended up in the hospital for surgery, and I was there a long 8 days. No visitors, of course. When I was released the end of May, I expected to have my Social Security check come the 1st of June. Well, it didn't show up. I called the bank and I said, how come I don't have my money? And they said, we've never seen any indication that we ever got any. Because somebody, somewhere, decided I was dead. And I can tell you, it took me months and months and months and more months to get back in the land of the living. One of the funny things about that time, if you can look for a funny thing in all this trauma, I got a check from Amazon. It was payable to the estate of Wilma Doan. At first, I thought I'd just keep the check as a souvenir. And then I thought, no, I'm going to take it to the bank, and I'm going to see if they'll cash it. And you know what? They did. This dead person standing there in front of them, getting their check. But through all this terrible, traumatic time in my life, there was something happening out there among you. You were sending me love and care in ways that was so important. You sent me cards. You sent me emails. You phoned me. And there was a dear friend that shortly after Ken died started sending me a text message every single morning. And she is not excuse me, she has not missed a single day. I got one this morning, and I'm looking forward to the one I'll get tomorrow. This was so drastically needed by me, to know that in all this isolation that I was feeling, there were people like you that cared me, cared about me and loved me. Your prayers were felt. My three children and my granddaughter were always there to help me during this difficult time, but it was your love coming towards me that kept me somewhat sane and stable. I have a personal philosophy. It is adventures in life, surprised by joy. And I want to encourage each and every one of you this morning as you leave this congregation to go about your daily week. Think of somebody in your life that maybe you haven't connected with. Send them a text message. Give them a call. Go visit. Let them know that you love and care for them too. And I know that a little joy will fall into their lives, and some of it probably will fall into yours too. God bless all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Wilma. Yes, this congregation is pretty amazing in our care. 2 Corinthians 9:6 tells us that the one who sows sparingly will reap sparingly, but the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. In the 3 years that I have been a part of this congregation, I have learned that this is a congregation that sows bountifully. We dream big. We love being engaged with one another and the world around us, and we are deeply committed to service, both within and beyond our church community. So I love that. It's one of the reasons that I enjoy my work with you, and I suspect it is one of the reasons why we continue to have new people joining our ranks. Speaking of which, representatives of our session are going to be meeting directly after worship today to welcome two more members into our church community. Yeah. So we are currently in a season of growing into our crop of hope that we have sown. As Josh said last week, 3 years ago, our church took a stretch of faith, adding new staff and new ministries, my position included, all of which our budget is still continuing to expand into and to support. So as I was considering my response to this call, one of the things that gave me confidence in accepting it was the wisdom that your leadership had demonstrated in developing a strategy for this budget transition. Of course, none of us anticipated a pandemic in that plan, But I think that makes the progress that we have made even that much more remarkable. However, we do still have work to do. I really love working with you, and I'd like to stay along with the rest of our staff. And I also want to see us continue to do great ministry in our community and beyond by supporting our local and international partners, by sustaining ministries like HELP, which celebrated 10 years of ministry this year and will be navigating some leadership changes in the coming year, and by starting new ministries like we did with Breakfast with Our Neighbors this year and starting and restarting several new study groups as well. So all of this requires our time, our attention, and our volunteer hours, but it also requires our financial support. So as we begin the season of Advent, this season of anticipation, and as we celebrate the Sunday of Hope, we are also dedicating our 2024 pledges. So thank you to everyone who has already submitted their pledge, and especially to those who have increased their intended giving for 2024. And if you are returning your pledge card today, we invite you to place them in the offering box as you exit the sanctuary, and thank you as well. So if you are still considering a pledge and there is anything that we can do to assist you in that decision, Josh and I or any of the members of our generosity team will be glad to meet with you, and you can return a pledge at any time. In addition to placing them in the offering box, you may also bring or mail them to the church office Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 4 p.m., or you can make a pledge online at vanfpc.church/pledge2024. Regular giving can also be made in all of those ways with online giving at vanfpc.church/giving. We are so incredibly grateful for all the ways that you support our shared ministry. And in addition to your pledges this year, we also covet your prayers as our leaders discern God's direction for our budget and our ministries in the year ahead. So may we continue to be a bountiful church. Let us pray. God of abundance, we know that Christ has called us to live generous and grateful lives as a response to the amazing generosity that you have shown to us. As we offer our gifts this week, and as we commit ourselves to supporting our shared ministry in the year ahead, may you use our dollars and the whole of our lives for the fulfillment of Christ's ministry. May our gifts help to free the captives, heal the sick, comfort the lonely, feed the hungry, and heal the wounded. And as Christ's hands and feet, may we be partners with your Holy Spirit, continuing to build your beloved community. Amen. This is the feast of the people of God. As we gather here at this table, every time we remember, we look back on all that Christ has done. We look at our present time and all that Christ is doing now. And we look ahead to all that Christ will continue to do for us. We remember everyone who gathers here, both everyone in our congregation, those who have come before us, those who will come after, and those around the world. And we remember that we are all here at the invitation of Jesus. This is Christ's table, and he invites every one of us who puts our trust in him to come and to share in the feast he has prepared.
Let us pray. How can we thank you, O God, for sun and moon and stars, for breath and life and all things good, for your steadfast promise and your faithful love, for the day that is surely coming when all things will be made new. With saints, with angels, and with the whole creation, we join the ancient and eternal hymn, giving you thanks, Holy God, for Jesus, who came to be your living word, to baptize us with spirit and fire, to feed the hungry, to humble the mighty, and to announce the good news of your coming realm. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, this bread, this cup, these people, Christ's body and blood given in love for the world. Make us one in the Spirit, one in the church, and one with Christ our Lord. Make us gentle, joyful, thankful people, serving our neighbors, worshiping you alone. Keep us in the peace of Christ until you gather us at your table in glory. Even now, a voice is crying in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord." Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
As we gather here, we remember how Christ gathered at the table with his disciples. And when they were there, he took bread and he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after the meal, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it." So friends, every time that we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Today we will be receiving communion by coming forward via the center aisle. You will then take the elements from either of the stations on the side and then return to your seats by the side aisle. We invite you to eat the bread as you feel led and ready to do so, but please hold the cup until the end so that we can share it together. So come, all things are made ready.
Light the hearts of all in dark and shadow. For you, O Lord, my soul in stillness waits. Truly my hope is in you. O spring of joy, rain down upon our spirits. Our thirsty hearts are yearning for your word. Come make us whole, be comfort to our hearts. For you, O Lord, my soul in stillness waits. Truly my hope is in you. soul in stillness waits. Truly my hope is in you. O root of life, implant your seed within us, and in your advent, draw us all to you. Our hope reborn in dying and in rising. For you, O Lord, my soul in stillness waits. Truly my hope is in you.
Let us share the cup of salvation together.
Let us pray. God, our hope, we give you thanks that you have given us this foretaste of the justice, righteousness, and peace of your promised new creation. Strengthen us with this heavenly food as we seek to serve your holy realm. Lead us to live in joyful expectation of the coming again in glory of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. Please stand in body or in spirit for our closing hymn. Now may the light of Christ, the love of God, and the life of the Holy Spirit shine on you and through you now and forevermore. Amen.